also. And indeed, I will talk about this new research we just preprinted a few days ago, 3 days ago. But first, we need to do a little bit of introduction about inheritance and memory, so you'll understand the context. So first of all, I would like to say that, I mean, there is evidence, and it's indirect, that memories, that we are not born a completely blank slate, that some memories are innate, or some of the things that we know about is the world are innate. And we, the Greek philosophers talked about it, and we know it also from some laboratory work. For example, in the 80s in the United States, people did experiments with monkeys. And these monkeys were born in captivity in the lab. So they didn't know anything about the world aside from what the researchers showed them. And they found, the researchers, that when you try to get them to be afraid of certain things, it's really difficult. So for example, if you take, if you bring them a toy flower and you want them to think that the toy flower is scary, you need to pair the flower to something scary, like an electric shock, multiple times until they learn that the toy is scary. So they don't have the tendency to be afraid of the toy. However, if you expose them to a toy snake, they are not born with the fear of toy snakes. However, it's enough to just pair them, the snake, with an electric shock once, and they will forever remember that snakes are scary. So they were born with the tendency to be afraid of snakes, but not flowers. This is somehow encoded in their genetic material, the heritable material, but it's not exactly clear how, because we don't know enough about memory. Memory is a very elusive concept. It's even hard to define a little bit, and people argue about the definitions. And you may know, those of you who are interested in neuroscience, that people normally, when they think about memories, they think about, they believe that the memories are encoded in synapses, in the connections between neurons in the brain. So for example, you learn something, some synapses get stronger, some get weaker, and you sculpt the particular neuronal architecture to remember. However, memories that are inherited transgenerationally cannot be synaptic by definition, because we are all born from a single cell, a fertilized egg. And at this point, since there's only one cell around, obviously it's not connected to other cells with synapses. So the memory, if it is transmitted across generation, has to be present in some molecular form. It could be in the DNA or maybe other molecules. And the dream is that, unlike memories in the brain, which are really hard to get to because they're all over the brain in, you know, millions of billions of synapses, these memories that transmit, when they transmit between generations, maybe at this particular point, they are amenable to characterization. Maybe we can just sequence them like we do with DNA or RNA, or maybe we can manipulate. So I think that heritable memory is a really interesting opportunity to think about memory. And this is difficult to do in humans, and in humans or mice or any other animal, pretty much, it's very difficult to understand how memories are encoded in the brain, since the brains are so immensely complex. So in our brains, we have many billions of neurons, and each neuron forms thousands of synapses. In C. elegans nematodes, the situation is simpler. It's still complex, but it's much simpler because they only have 302 neurons. And all together in their entire brain or nervous system, they have 7,000 synapses. So it's much, much simpler. So this is why we study worms. And while the worms can't do many things that humans can, they can't tweet and so on, they can perform complex behaviors such as smelling thousands of odors, mating, sensing heat and touch, and even learning simple things about the world. For example, an association between food and odor, or between food and something scary. So they can learn that. And so I think it's a unique opportunity to study memory in C. elegans, because it's like the, you know, if you want to study atoms, you want to start with the hydrogen. So maybe the nervous system of the worm is the simplest nervous system we can study, pretty much. We also have, and this is unique for C. elegans, a connectome. We know about each neuron with which other neurons it connects. It's like a subway map of the entire nervous system. And it's always the same between isogenic worms, which is also something that's special, because, I mean, even if I had a twin brother, I don't, then our brains would be connected completely differently. It would change dynamically. With the worms, it's pretty much hardwired. So you know the nervous system, you know that every neuron has a name and you know exactly with which neurons it connects. And the worm is also transparent. You can actually see the worms, the neurons fire and function. Okay. Can memories be inherited? So I want to start with this tweet from a few years ago that got a fair amount of attention from Kevin Mitchell. And he talks in this tweet specifically about mammals, but it's the same. I mean, conceptually. What he says is that behavior is encoded by the nervous system, cannot transfer to the next generations because pretty much if I use my own words, you have his words in front of you, the language has a certain, the brain has a certain language and inheritance uses a different language. So the language of the brain is neuron to neuron activity or connection or communication and synapses that gets weakened and stronger and so on. And inheritance functions through DNA or through epigenetic changes on the chromatin. And there's no way, according to him, to translate the information that's embedded in the neuronal architecture to the language of inheritance and move it out of neurons into the germline. And even if there was such magic that allows this to happen, there needs to be a second stage where you get the memory out of the germline, out of the single cell, really the fertilized egg in the next generation, and back to the developing nervous system of the next generation. And then the memory would somehow have to find the right place in the right circuit and sit in the specific synapses where it was encoded in the previous generation. And when you put it this way, it indeed sounds crazy and totally impossible. If I summarize what he's saying in this tweet, he's saying you can transfer memory from the neurons to the germline, and then you can't bring them back from the germline to the nervous system in the next generations. Okay. And I will show you today that all of this is not needed really for memories or behavior to be transmitted, to be changed transgenerationally. And even Kevin Mitchell now agrees, and I don't have his tweet here, but I can show it to you later on Twitter if you wish or elsewhere, that he also tweeted that he is convinced by our work that in C. elegans it does happen. In mammals, it's a different story. It's more complicated and remains to be proven. Okay, so the first difficulty that he raises, this inability to, the theoretical inability to move the information from the neurons to the germline, is part of a bigger concept that's called the second law of biology or the Weismann barrier. Some of you may have heard of it. The first law of biology being natural selection. The second law of biology is this principle that August Weismann in the 19th century coined, which says that information, that what happens in the soma stays in the soma, the germline is segregated from the rest of the body and therefore also from the environment. The somatic activity or responses cannot become genetic, they cannot be inherited, cannot move to the germline. And he didn't use these words because these words didn't exist like genetics, but that's what he said, that the germline is the only tissue that can transmit information to the next generation. And he came up with this principle to show that Lamarckian inheritance of acquired traits cannot happen. The tissues that interact with the environment cannot transmit the information or the responses to the next generation. And this is largely the dogma until today, pretty much. Okay, only changes in the germline gets inherited. We know that this is compatible with genetic inheritance because, for example, if you get a mutation in your skin, I mean, there's no way to transmit this mutation to the germline also, to the sperm or the egg. So what happens in the skin will not affect the next generation. And the same thing, I mean, if you go to the gym and you build muscles, your kids won't be stronger as a result because there's no way to transmit the change in the muscles to the next generation. Okay, so this seems to fit normal DNA-based genetics. And also we know that epigenetic changes, modifications of the chromatin, of DNA for DNA methylation or histone modifications, they get largely erased in the germline and in embryogenesis. So there's also a resetting or reprogramming of the epigenetic information so that the next generation can start as a blank slate. So it seems like Weismann is right and his second law is holding on. However, I wouldn't be talking to you if there wasn't a breach, and there is, because C. elegans don't care much about the Weismann barrier. We know since the seminal work of Fire and Mello that got them the Nobel Prize, that if you feed worms with double-strand RNA producing bacteria, the double-strand RNA will induce RNAi in silencing not only in the gut, the site of ingestion, but also it would move and spread systemically to other tissues. There are other organisms where RNAi spread systemically as well. And it will also get to the germline and affect and execute silencing in the next generations. They didn't know what was being transferred, whether it's the small RNAs themselves or other changes, like changes to the chromatin that small RNAs also enforce. But it's clear that the silencing moves out of the soma and to the germline. And we now know that the agents, that the molecular agent that move between cells and reaches the germline are small RNAs. And in my work at the postdoc that I did with Oliver Hobert at 2011, we've shown that small RNAs are actually the agents that move between generations. We sequenced heritable small RNAs for the first time. We find that they are amplified in every generation, so they won't be diluted. I'll talk about it more. And we saw that they can have physiological relevance, or they can have functions. So it's not only artificial double-strand RNA that you feed the worms or inject the worms. These are also small RNAs that are made endogenously or in response to viruses, for example. So in 2011, we showed that when you infect worms with viruses, they produce a transgenerational response that protects the virus against the virus in the next generations. And worms are remarkably immune to viruses. There are barely any viruses that infect C. elegans. It's really amazing on its own. And many people studied it since. And we also showed that when you starve the worms, you get a transgenerational response that in the next generations make the worms live longer. And other people have shown that it also affects other qualities or traits in the next generations. For example, the worms that descend from ancestors that were starved are more resistant to additional rounds of starvation that are more severe. So this seems like an adaptive response. Other studies have shown that changes in temperature can also be inherited. So if you grow the worm at a certain temperature, that will leave a mark on the next generations. And recently, that if you expose the worms to different pathogenic bacteria, it can change the next generation. They would make them more protected against additional rounds of bacterial infections. And we have shown last year, and this is very important in my opinion, I will expand on it a little bit, that changes in neuronal activity or small RNA production in neurons can transmit transgenerationally via small RNAs, and that it changes also the behavior of the next generation. And I'll explain what we found in a few slides. Okay, why do the worms do it? Why is it good for them? Is it good for other organisms as well? Before we talk about it, I want to show you a short clip, just 1 minute, from one of my favorite movies. It's called The Groundhog Day. I don't know if you've seen it, but you should. It's really a funny movie, and it's a great movie. And in this movie, to those who haven't seen it, Bill Murray, the actor in this film, something weird happens to him. He wakes up and you're in the same day over and over. So he relives the same day every day for years, for 20 or 50 years. So he knows exactly what is going to happen, because no matter what he does, it will be the same day over and over again. So he becomes an expert of that particular day and knows how to exploit his environment, his restricted environment, because he doesn't move out of this small town perfectly. And I will just show you one clip where he uses this information that he acquires to rob a bank.
A gust of wind. Dog bark. Cue the truck. Exit Herman. Walk under the bank. Exit Felix and stand there with a not so bright look on your face. All right, Doris, come on. Hey, fix your bra, honey. That's better. Felix! How you doing, Doris? Can I have a roll of quarters? 10, 9, 8, R, 6, 5 quarters, 3, 2,
Felix, what, did I bring up 2 bags or what? I don't know.
Yeah, so you see, for Bill Murray in this movie, it's like for us during Corona, where every day is the same. And this is the situation for worms always, because their generation time is so short, it's just 3.5 days, that the likelihood that the parents' environment will resemble the children's environment is very high. And changes that happen over a course of multiple generations, because the generation time is so short. So for example, the worm finds an apple and then it will eat the apple. It will take a few generations of worms, then there are many worms, to consume the apple. And at this point, the worms will be starved for multiple generations, sort of a boom-bust type of a lifestyle. So it's worth transmitting your information if you can predict what would happen, which is why I think worms do it. We can discuss whether this is the same in other organisms later. The response in C. elegans, and this is key, can persist multiple generations because it's amplifiable. In our 2011 paper, we've shown that small RNAs that are inherited across generations are continuously made in the next generations. So you need to know this about small RNAs in C. elegans. There are different types of small RNAs. They can have, you can have exogenous small RNAs that derive directly from the double-stranded RNA substrate. They can be endogenous small RNAs, like endo, siRNAs, or pi RNAs. All of these primary small RNAs do not lead directly to silencing. What they do is they recruit to the mRNA RNA-dependent RNA polymerases, polymerases that use mRNA as template to synthesize more abundant small RNAs that are called amplified small RNAs or secondary small RNAs. And they have a certain chemical composition and characteristics. They're mostly 22 nucleotides long, and they start with a G. And they can also template their own production again and again and again. So it's and every heritable agent needs to be able to replicate itself. This is also, of course, the secret of life with DNA, the fact that the two strands can serve as templates for amplification and making of additional strands. So it's the same with heritable small RNAs. That's what makes them special. They can amplify across generations. And you may ask yourself, why does it ever stop? I mean, if they can remake the small RNAs in every generation, why does it stop? And typically, responses stop after 3 to 5 generations. This is at least true for responses that start with the administration of double-stranded RNA. Typically, it stops after 3 to 5 generations at the population level, on average. And we've shown in this 2016 paper that it stops because there's a timer, a transgenerational timer, that stops the response, a sort of a feedback that stops the response after a few generations. And the timer, you can read the paper, I won't expand on it because we don't have time, is in itself built out of small RNAs, but there are also proteins that make up the machinery of the timer. And the genes that encode for these proteins, we call them MOTEC genes. MOTEC stands for modified transgenerational epigenetic inheritance. Sorry, just a second. Yeah, modified transgenerational epigenetic kinetics. Wait just a second. And a MOTEC. Yes, sorry. Now you can hear me. Sorry. And MOTEC also means sweetheart in Hebrew. So it's a sort of a joke that only Israelis understand. But these genes, if you mutate these genes, it changes the course of inheritance dramatically. For example, there's one gene, MUT2, which is a H3K9 methyl transferase, that acts to erase inheritance. And if you mutate it, then responses will just last forever, or tens or hundreds of generations. Very recently, just a few months ago, we published a paper which shows that while at the population level, the response typically stops after 3 to 5 generations, but if you look at individuals and individual lineages, then there's great variability between individuals. And the segregation of the response, of the silencing across a lineage in the population, follows 3 simple rules, which are very different from the rules that explain genetic inheritance, the Mendelian inheritance, which just, I mean, basically reflect meiosis. Here, it's something different. There is a, again, I won't talk about it too much, but there's a stochastic expression of HSF1, which is a transcription factor that creates variability intentionally between lineages, and we can predict for how long each worm will transmit the response to the next generations. Okay. I want to say a last word on neuronal inheritance before we go to this new stuff. As I've shown you, as I've briefly told you, changes in small RNAs in neurons lead to transgenerational inheritance. We've shown this by taking an animal worm that doesn't have a gene that's needed for producing small RNAs, a particular small RNAs, and rescuing this small RNA gene just in the neurons. And we've shown that the small RNAs move probably non-cell autonomously and affect small RNA production in the germline and transgenerational silencing of mRNAs in the germline. In fact, we don't know that whether they move themselves or whether they affect other compounds like hormones or something like this that affect the germline. In the end, there's changes in response to the changes in the nervous system that affect small RNA production in the germline, which progress for multiple generations. And these small RNAs that are made in neurons of the parents are required for the progeny for at least 3 generations to be able to find food, to do chemotaxis under stressful conditions. And we identified one gene, SAGE2, which is transgenerationally regulated in the germline in response to production of endogenous small RNAs in the nervous system of the grandparents. And regulation of SAGE2 is required for transgenerational regulation of chemotaxis. Okay. What many people missed in that paper, although we said it very explicitly, is that we identified a sort of a reverse Weismann barrier. If you remember, the Weismann barrier is this old principle that says that the information from the stroma can't get to the germline. Well, in fact, what we're seeing is the opposite. Responses can move from the germline, small RNA responses, from the stroma to the germline. However, they get trapped in the germline. The genes continue to be silenced in the germline, and the silencing doesn't move out of the germline in the next generation back to the stroma. So we tracked, for example, mRNA silencing using single molecule FISH, and we see that the targets in the germline continue to be silenced for multiple generations, while the genes in the stroma get re-expressed. We don't know what constitutes this reverse Weismann barrier, but we're studying it. Now, you may ask yourself, how can you affect behavior transgenerationally if the response doesn't go back to the nervous system? This is like this Kevin Mitchell tweet that I started with, right? You need to get the response to the germline. This I've shown you can happen in C. elegans, but then you have to get it out of the germline back to the neurons. It makes sense because normally we think about inheritance as being controlled by the nervous system. Well, it doesn't have to be that way. There are many examples. In fact, it's quite trivial. It shows that you can affect behavior by affecting the germline. So for example, think of castrated dogs. You affect the germ cells and it affects their behavior. And it's also that the changes that go in puberty affect our behavior, although we are affecting germ cells or the germline. And this was also specifically shown in C. elegans. So if you ablate the oocytes or the germ or the sperm, you affect behavior, and in particular, you affect chemotaxis behavior. This has been shown. And it might be happening because the germline secretes all kinds of compounds to the stroma, or because of changes that occur throughout development. But this is very crucial. It's crucial for the rest of the talk, this principle. And we wanted to know which other behaviors can be affected by transgenerational regulation of the germline. By the way, there are exceptions where some somatic responses continue to be affected transgenerationally, but these are very rare and we don't understand it. But most of the responses affect the germline, and we wanted to see which transgenerational effect through the germline can affect behavior in the next generations. Moreover, we wanted to know whether this can affect evolution, the process of evolution, whether the changes in behavior can affect the process of evolution indirectly. And indirect effects are sometimes very important. And we just preprinted this paper 3 days ago. So let me explain to you what we found. So worms can choose whether to self-fertilize or whether to outcross to mate with males. They are hermaphrodites, so they make both sperm and eggs and can fertilize themselves. However, there are also males with which they can mate. However, mating with males is very costly, because when you mate with males, first of all, it takes energy, you risk predation, and importantly, you dilute your genetic contribution, because the hermaphrodites will donate half of its genome, and the male will donate half of its genome. So you dilute it by half. And if you want to transmit your genes to the next generation, that's a compromise. However, sometimes it's worth it. It's worth it because when you mate, you increase variability, genomic diversity. And then natural selection have more options to choose from. I mean, for evolution, you need two things. You need variation, and then you have selection, but you have to have variation. And when you mate, you dramatically increase variation, and that's helpful in unpredicted and stressful situations where you need some new inventions to save yourselves or the species. And it has been shown even specifically in worms, in C. elegans, that if you co-evolved worms with a pathogen, then mating is preferable. The worms mate more to increase probably genetic diversity. The worms are smart. So they start secreting pheromones, the hermaphrodites do, to attract the males. But they do it only at a particular developmental stage. They do it when they become old, because they have a limited amount of sperm. And once they stop making the sperm when they become old, they can't fertilize themselves anymore. And if they want to continue making babies, they have to get new supply of sperm. And they do it by secreting this pheromone that attracts the males. And then the males, so if you take worms and you extract their odors, you see that the young hermaphrodites are not attractive at all. And the older hermaphrodites are, the pheromones that you extract from them are more attractive to males. So if you put the sperm in the male in the middle of the plate, it will be only attracted to worms that are old. To the odors that were extracted from the worms that are old. The worms are not even on the plate, just the odors that are extracted from them. And I thought that maybe this process will be affected by environmental conditions or stress, because we know that the sperm can be susceptible to stress. And also, small RNAs are affected by stress and transmit responses to stress transgenerationally. And small RNAs are very important in regulating both the well-being of the oocyte and the well-being of the sperm. And mutants in small RNAs, in small RNA inheritance in particular, have this transgenerational sterility phenotype. It's called MOT, motile germline phenotype. Okay, yeah, so you see these endogenous small RNAs that regulate germline genes. So do environmental challenges affect sexual attraction? Well, in the beginning, we tested multiple different environments to see whether the stress, any particular stress, can make the worms attractive already when they're young, when they shouldn't be attractive. And the students who did these experiments, a few students worked on it, but mostly it was Itai. And Itai looks exactly like this actor from the movie Perfume. Maybe you've seen it. It's about a serial killer that extracts the odors from his victims, the victims that he kills. And what Itai does is he takes the hermaphrodites and he extracts their odors, and then he places the odors from the worms on the slide on the lid of the plate in one place, and he puts a control odor on the other place, and he puts about 100 males in the middle and sees whether the males prefer the odors that were extracted from the hermaphrodites to the control odor. And when Itai did this experiment, so first of all, he started by checking starvation, because L1 starvation during the first larval stage, was the first condition that we showed to lead to transgenerational responses through small RNAs. But we found that the worms that are starved in L1 are not more attractive. They are not attractive when they're young, only when they're old. As a control, Itai always uses worms that are mutants that are called FOG2 that are defective in sperm, so in sperm production, so they don't have sperm. So the sensor that senses whether the sperm continues to fertilize the eggs is activated, and they start secreting the pheromone already when they're young. So they're always attractive. We also checked starvation during the dower stage, which is a longer starvation, also shown in the past to cause transgenerational effects, and high temperatures. we grow the worms at 25 degrees instead of 20 degrees, which is a mild stress. You can still, the worms are still fertile, but it's a mild stress. And we saw that this doesn't make them more attractive. However, we found that if you grow the worms in 25 degrees for multiple generations, for about 10 generations, then they start being attractive. So they secrete this pheromone and become attractive to the worms, to the maize in a very robust way, almost like these spermless worms, the FOG2 mutants. And the attraction of the odors that they secrete depends on a receptor that is called SRD1, which is a pheromone receptor that is expressed only by one neuron, sensory neuron in the male that's called AWA. So we know that this is mediated by the same process that make worms attractive, that make spermless worms attractive to males. The worms are not only more attractive, they also mate more with the males. So, I mean, being attractive and secreting a pheromone is one thing, but you also need to mate is a complicated thing. It's a ritual. And we to see whether the worms that that you put in high temperatures are more attractive also, we put them in a competition with worms that were cultivated in normal temperatures in 20 degrees. And we had the worms express different fluorophores, and we use males that have fluorescent sperms that we can track. And we saw, so we put them together, all of them together on the same plate, and then we remove the male, and then we look for the fluorophore, for the fluorescent sperm. And we can see that the worms that were cultivated in high temperatures for multiple generations are inseminated more with the fluorescent sperm. So it's not only that they are more attractive, they also mate more with the males. This is just a quantification of this. You see that worms that were cultivated in high temperatures mate more, just like or more than wild type worms, and almost as good as worms that don't make sperm, these FOG2 mutants that we use as a control. But is it inherited? That's of course the most interesting question. Is it inherited also to worms that are not grown, that are grown in normal temperatures? It is, otherwise, wouldn't be such a big story, in my opinion. And so you see, if you grow the worms for 10 generations to 25, and then you move them to 20, they remain attractive for three generations before the attraction peters out, before it's gone. And it's very interesting that for me, that you need to grow them for multiple generations in 25 degrees, slightly mildly stressful temperatures for them to become attractive. Because it's a little bit like this Groundhog Day movie that I've shown you. If the environment constantly fluctuates and changes and you don't know what to expect, then it might not be worth it to transmit a response to the next generation. However, if the worm can predict, we're trying to get into the brains of the worms, if they can predict that the environment will now be like this, stressful, because they experience this environment, something accumulates, then it's worth it to prepare the progeny from the same stress. And this is what happens. Does it happen because of inheritance of small RNAs? To check this, normally what we do in other assays also is to neutralize the machinery that is needed for transgenerational inheritance. And there are different components that affect small RNA inheritance. And it depends also on the stress and the condition, but there's one gene that encodes for a protein that's called HRD1. And HRD1, the acronym is heritable RNA deficient 1. And this is an argonaut protein that carries small RNAs in the germline, one of the 27 argonauts that C. elegans has, which is needed for most small RNA responses, transgenerational small RNA responses. You can see in this slide, this is a picture from one of Scott Kennedy's papers in Nature, that worms that express GFP in the germline, if you expose the parents to RNAi, they silence it just fine, but the response doesn't move to the next generation. So it's needed just for transgenerational silencing. The problem is, we wanted to check whether this is captured in HRD1 mutants. The problem is that HRD1 mutants are sterile at 25 degrees. So it's difficult to do transgenerational studies. So what we did is we tagged the endogenous locus of HRD1 using CRISPR. We added a degron tag to the protein, HRD1, and we expressed the enzyme that degrades the degron. only in the germline using a tissue-specific promoter. This is a system that comes from plants. And TIR1 degrades degron tagged proteins, HRD1 in this case, only when you add auxin, which is a hormone in plants, to the system. So it's an inducible way of removing HRD1. And we saw that when we remove HRD1 in the progeny, the worms stop being in transgenerationally attractive. If you just remove it in the parents are still attractive, but the response doesn't move to the next generation. So this means that transgenerational attraction depends on small RNAs, on HRD1 carried small RNAs. We have additional controls of just the degrons, and that's just the auxin and so on. Which small RNAs are involved in this? Which small RNAs get inherited? To see this, to dissect the contribution of the different pathways to the inheritance, we checked many different mutants. So we checked about 15 mutants that are defective in the production of different small RNAs and different steps in the in small RNA pathways. And we identified four mutants, ALG5, PRG1, Dicer helicase mutant, and a double mutant in MEG3 and 4 that I'll expand on, that are prematurely attractive. So you extract the odors from these worms when they're young and they're attractive. And they are not only more attractive, they also mate more with males, all of these mutants. However, only one of these mutants, it's a double mutant, defective in MEG3 and MEG4, and I'll explain about these genes in a second, leads to a transgenerational response of attraction. So if you start with the homozygous mutant, and then you cross it to wild type and you isolate after two generations wild type worms, they remain attractive for three generations at least before they stop being attractive, which means that the inheritance that resulted from the defect in MEG3 and 4 transmitted to the next generation. And the inheritance in response to disruption of these genes is dependent on HRD1, this argonaut that we also found to be necessary for transgenerational inheritance of heat stress. MEG3-4 are core germ granules proteins. These germ granules we've shown in a previous paper are needed for sorting of the genes that will be transgenerationally signed by small RNAs. Here you can see them move outside of the nucleus. These germ granules are liquid-like components and they reside outside of the nucleus. And when the mRNA exits the nuclear pore, it passes through these three germ granules, the P granule, and then to the M granule, then to the Z granule, and then to the M granule. And small RNAs are made in these germ granules. Many of the proteins that are needed for small RNA synthesis are there. And then an mRNA gets selected for silencing or for expression. And when you disrupt the expression of the MEG3-4 genes, then you get a transgenerational changes in the levels of many endogenous small RNAs that come from all over the genome. And these changes persist for multiple generations and also lead to some phenotypes that persist for multiple generations. So it's a very dramatic disruption of the heritable small RNA pool. And the genes that get changed transgenerationally are when you disrupt MEG3-4, are enriched in genes that function in sperm functions. And this is true also when you look at small RNAs that are in enrichments in small RNAs that are changed following growth in high temperatures. So we thought maybe what's happening is that the small RNAs that get changed across generations in response to stress or when you disrupt this pathway, they harm the sperm. And when you don't have functional sperm, then it's like being old, you start secreting this pheromone. To see whether they have a defect in sperm, we did this experiment. Normally, MEG3-4 have a brood size defect, which also exacerbates over time, it becomes worse. They have a lower brood size. However, it can stem from other defects in the oocyte or from defects in the sperm. So what we did is we took the MEG3-4 mutants and also wild type mutants and we cracked. So now the sperm is being donated by wild-type males. And when they get wild-type males, you see that it largely corrects their germline phenotype, the defect in the brood size, which means that they have a defect in sperm. They're still fertile, but something's wrong with the sperm. Can this transgenerational attraction affect the genetic structure of the population and therefore also evolution? This is the question that we started with, the most interesting one. Well, to check this, I mean, you can tell it, you have all kinds of theories about evolution, but to check evolution, you have to do lab evolution, to see it live in front of your eyes as it unfolds. So what we did is we took worms that are genetically identical. They're exactly the same, only they come from different ancestries. Some of these worms, and we can distinguish between the two groups of worms because they are marked with fluorophores. They express different fluorescent proteins. And so one of these groups come from a lineage of wild type worms. So they have been wild type for many, many generations. And the other group is wild type now, but they are descendants of MEK34 mutants. So a few generations ago, they were mutants, but now they're wild type. So they are the same, only they're different epigenetically. One is transgenerationally attractive, epigenetically attractive, and the others are not. And then we put these worms together with males on plates together with food and everything for multiple generations. We just let them compete over the mating and the food and everything. And we want to see what happens, whether the genes that come from the attractive lineage become more abundant, whether they take over. And we take pictures of the worms, differentiating between fluorescent and non-fluorescent worms, and we analyze everything using a machine learning automated software that we published a few years ago that's called Worm Machine, that allows us to look at many worms. And we do this huge experiment in two parallel backgrounds, in wild-type worms and also in mutants that don't have SRD1, which is the pheromone receptor that is needed in the males to sense the pheromone. It is secreted when the worms don't have sperm. So we can see whether sensing the pheromone makes a difference. And it does. What happens is that the worms that come from the epigenetically attractive lineage mate more and produce more offsprings. And this is especially apparent when you look at the males. So it changes the population structure of the entire population structure and help them propagate their genes and their alleles. So this is my last slide, just a summary slide. The theory that we propose is that, first of all, small RNA inheritance is a regulated process. Small RNAs themselves can be inherited and they can transmit different environments to the next generation, including neuronal activity. And when you elevate the temperature, the worm starts secreting small RNAs or have a defect in small RNA inheritance that makes them transgenerationally more attractive. And this might rescue them from the sterility that typifies worms that become defective in epigenetic processes. And when they are more attractive, they also mate more and spread their alleles in the population. And small RNA inheritance segregates according to a specific set of rules, which can predict which will inherit and which will not inherit, even in populations of completely isogenic progeny. This project also includes a mathematical analysis that I will not discuss. It was performed by Yael and Lilach. And they made a model, a population genetics based model that predicts when will this be adaptive in nature. And this is also a collaboration with Shai Shacham from Rockefeller University in New York, where my student Itai, who is the first author, has spent the last year performing some experiments. So I would just like to thank everyone in the lab, especially the Itai, Yael, and Itamar, who led this particular story. And thank you for listening. And I'll, of course, be very happy to discuss this and take any questions. So thank you very much.